so it's around 6 o'clock we're on at the Women's Subcommittee. I'm wearing apologies for the Councillor Inglis, just in case. Okay, so we'll start with our agenda then. Item one of the minutes of the meeting on the 7th of November. Correct record, new members of correct record.
Again, sorry, through you, Chair. The it's allowed in planning to use those sort of those terms, but there are, you know, people are talking about green technologies, a revolution in green technology, and whether the language is up to speed with current thinking. Now, I've got an overall comment to make when we get to the end of the document, because these documents, by their very nature, aren't particularly exciting. But I'm hoping when this is backing up a local plan, that the preface or the commentary around the local plan can say, we want to be, you know, the world leader in green technology, we want to be the best in something or other. So it's just where you can use the correct, you know, the most modern language and the most up-to-date sort of thinking on green technology in particular, and other members can think of any other technologies. We need to be up to speed with those technologies, and you know, I'm not expert enough to know what they are, but there will be people out there who can advise the council. Okay.
So possibly in that third bullet point where it just says greener growth, we're a bit more specific.
Yeah.
In terms of the technology, yes.
Sorry, it does specifically mention offshore wind, and it should be mentioning solar, for instance.
Well, yeah, that's what I'm saying, whether you know, it's all encompassing, it's a phrase that covers all of those.
Yeah, always a danger list, isn't there? So I suppose offshore wind and the local company, yeah, these are examples of what we want, I suppose, yeah. So like a definitive. Just just wonder whether we should try and get it out to them now, so if they have concerns before we go on to formal consultation. That's the point you're making, isn't it?
I just think we can all get a lot of things as many books as possible.
That's what we said we wanted to do for the conservation areas, we talk to them in advance so that they weren't objective later. You know, so I don't know whether we can just say, well, these are the drafts, this is a formal consultation, this is where we're up to, have we got any comments to make at this stage? And then if something is raised by the likes of the chamber, or other business bodies, excellence of the council, it can be taken into account before we go to a more formal consultation.
Yes, certainly all of that is possible. So for the Regulation 18 consultation, we'll be looking for that to be as extensive as possible. I think we'll do a particular focus group on businesses as well, so that they have the opportunity to comment on that. And yes, I mean, we can share these draft emerging policies with them and anybody else, and that, because they're all sort of public. And obviously, we want to get the buy-in from people to make sure they're the policies that will fit for determining planning applications for the next 15 years or so.
Yeah, I sort of take issue with the words economic growth, to be honest. If we're going to have a sustainable society and stop climate change, we really need economic stability. And I think growth is a bit of a word which sort of suggests that we are going to grow. And basically, we can't sustain economic growth, say, because this is one of the reasons why we have the difficulties we have in the world today. And really, we need to have sort of more sort of reuse and things like that, rather than use the word growth. I would prefer to use a different word than growth.
Of course,
that's
what we're doing.
For Will, economic growth would be not to be a net exporter of employees. So we could grow our economy at the same time make the world more sustainable, because our employees would not be travelling 30, 40 miles in a petrol driven or diesel driven vehicle. So it depends how you describe what is sustainable. Will is a net exporter of jobs rather than. So many of our people, they're trying to create jobs closer to home. So you can argue growth for women is actually more sustainable for the world as opposed to. So I think we need to keep it in terms that the rest of the world understand at this point in time. And we're not going to talk about growth.
That's just exploring, because I mean, the issue is obviously growth of the renewable energy sector is a desirable growth. And obviously there will be areas where we might see shrinkage. That's the issue. So it's not growth on its own that's the problem, it's whether the growth is sustainable in nature. So it might be, I'm looking at that page just below CS14, the policy box. Is that the line that you've looked at, Steve, where it says the world plan sets out how the council will work with partners to drive economic growth? I mean, possibly just the insertion of the word sustainable will actually clarify what it is that we're after, you know.
That's exactly the word I've got.
Is that where you've gone with that? Is that okay?
Chair, if we're going to add sustainable, I think you should say environmentally sustainable, because that makes it seem like it's the kind of growth that you can sustain. So the word sustainability, I think, is inherently environmental, unless you add environmental.
Yeah.
I would have to agree with Steve. I think we're talking about a plan for the future, but we are talking about a plan that we implemented now. Be anti-growth at a time when businesses rely on growth to hit their targets, to maintain, you know, viability, to talk to shareholders. If we still want that to happen within rural, then we still have to cater towards the way that the business environment is now, in terms of a long-term aspiration perhaps, but for now, I think being anti-growth would just close us off.
I wasn't sure that was the point that was being made, that the issue is some growth is desirable and some growth isn't. And I guess at the moment, at a microeconomic level, the way growth is measured can sometimes be wholly unsustainable. For example, if a ship sinks, it's causes growth, you can get a new ship. It's actually a living tragedy. You know. But if we go with environmental sustainability, that captures possibly what we're after. Yes,
I say it is happy to move on there, Chair, but you know, whilst I do see the Green Party's stance on growth, we can see how they're thinking. There's fundamental reasons why we need growth, and if we try and aim for no growth or shrinkage, then we're just sitting back in the room, chaos, famine, a whole load of things which comes into this. But overriding, it comes to the point before that Councillor Franks was making, MDPF, presumption for sustainability, overrides everything that should be in an energy plan. So, unless sustainability hasn't fit for today and fit for tomorrow, so MDPF does give us flexibility to work forward for 15 years and be adaptable to requirements that they tell us.
So, if we insert those words, you'll we'll be more in line with the new graphics, would be a nice thing as well.
Yeah, I think the way I'm more sustainable, that aligns Steve's concerns, that's well and good. However, you know, we'll say that having zero growth and no economic stability is okay if you pull the top of the tree. The wider interest is growth that supports people at the bottom of the tree, and I think there's lots of income inequality. There's any favours. We don't attract a level of growth. We try and bridge that gap, so the people at the bottom of the tree can enjoy some more economic success than the output. And it takes a bit of growth to achieve that.
Okay. The
definition of minus growth is recession. So you don't want us to be in recession, you want us to be sustainably growing.
Sustainably, sustainable. Okay, thank you for that. Exploring the definition of growth and yes. When we get close to being the conservation level.
Oh, absolutely, you're there.
it's a fair point to just try and get that right. Anything further than on CS14 and its session?
No.
Okay, so it comes down to CS15, criteria for employment development.
This is about office development and the policies to direct officers to existing centres. The crew will need to co-locate with an existing facility. Would we take leavers, for example, a sort of factory that needs to have an office on site. municipality, say we bring in a new manufacturer to the area, then officers that serve that business is quite acceptable to be located within the premises. It's officers that are, say, a commercial firm such as a bank or financial institution or something like that, as a standalone office, the policy is to direct them to the census.
That was equivalent, maybe just around language of explaining how you did that, just for clarity, like what's a centre, what's an existing facility, like, for clarity.
Okay,
okay,
well.
Try and cover that once.
running.
I think you have that as a separate.
Yeah, that's on the agenda.
Is that retail and town centre?
Yes.
Called the town centre.
I think I'd see specifically.
And that was the centre stuff. So it's a supermarket. You covered all the retail.
Is that okay? So that's, I think.
Yeah, okay. See what the players look like on that.
So we had a plan application recently for the fast food restaurants on the outskirts of the industrial estate. So will this policy cover last, or will the town centre's policy cover that?
Yeah, the town centres will, but the next policy at CS17 will also come into play on that as well.
Okay. Can you hold that thought then? See where we are when we get to CS17, yeah. And then we'll see where we are when we reach CS17, and we'll explore how the thought process will work through the policy on a takeaway on the industrial space. Okay, so if we can give that one some thoughts in, yeah, that's exactly the example that I'm in my mind, so no doubt you'll be able to cobble together the likes of other words. Anything else to CS15?
No.
Okay, CS16, criteria for poor related development. Same sentence, I don't know if you've read it. There's another word significance, but it doesn't say whether it's significant, what the significance is, so that the sentence doesn't quite make sense if you read it. There's either a word missing, which could be adverse or beneficial, or impact, significant impact.
We have to prove demonstrable harm, I think, is the phrase that's used. principle. So, you know, an example might be that there may be, you know, an overriding need to, I think, talk about dredging and stuff like that. If the immediate impact of any dredging would have an effect at that point in time, then if the experts say, well, over time, things will be covered because that's the nature of the world we live in, I think they're the sort of issues that would be sort of, if it was irreversible harm, then we would, you know, we'd have a different opinion about the application. I'm just trying to think out loud. So, you know, the officers are being given ideas and our thoughts at this panel, aren't they? So effectively, if the word demonstrable is linked with the planning issue, then we've got a bit more sort of more clear guidance for people, perhaps, rather than significance is right, is open to interpretation. I'm trying to be helpful.
And it is.
It's very much appreciated.
There's just a hanging and point six. Or is it linked to the final statement?
No, it doesn't.
Okay.
So my question is around for minimised environmental impact of residential areas. Now, given our major, or our main port-related sites is going to be West Coast, and Wirral is going to be mainly residential, will that have an impact on any development proposals, port-related development proposals on the West Coast, you know, given that if any ships to access the West Coast, they've got to go for these flows?
Our view would be that, you know, this policy is trying to dovetail in what the local plan would be. We have heavy reliance on that area to fill some of the housing gap. So just we need to bear that in mind.
Okay, I'm not mentioning we're also involved. There's jobs involved.
I understand what you're saying. Right. Yeah.
So what does that mean, Ali? Losing critical traffic to and from, which I guess is more than just. We're thinking more than just cars, presumably. We're talking delivery vehicles and HGVs, presumably. I think that relates to it. I might be wrong, but what do we have to layer on this for?
Yeah. I think what we're after there, I mean, clearly when we're putting new housing areas into existing industrial areas and trying to recreate the environment in that area, there will be some impacts that will need to be taken into account. So what we're looking to do here is to minimise any environmental impacts on the residential development. So when we're talking about routing protocols of traffic, it might be that we send them down certain roads and not others. So you obviously wouldn't send them through a residential area, for example, because that significant adverse impact on those areas. So you might move them around sort of industrial transport corridors. You might do certain works to actually separate the residential areas from the employment areas, so you have various buffers to keep the two land uses apart. And then you minimise the impact, as I said, by traffic routing and putting those other measures into place. So that's what that is saying in terms of that. And clearly it will come into play Wirral waters, because we are doing something different there from what we've done historically. But that in some ways is no different from other parts of the Wirral, places down in Broadbrook, for example, at the moment, where you've got, or Eastern in particular, you know, where you've got your interface with your housing and your conservation area in your port-related activities down there. So we'll be doing that environmental minimisation. So it's that type of idea, I think, that we're looking to cover with that particular point.
Yeah, so sending the lines a mile away, like we'd
the only other thing in the back of mind was there was one of the big economic drivers was for Mersey. I don't know still an ambitious on a regional basis, and is it taking place?
Yes, that is still an ambition. It's mainly taking place on the Liverpool Stoke Sefton side of things, obviously near the Panamax terminals and places like that. That's the main area for the deep water opportunities. The thing we have to be quite clear about is where we are in the position of the local plan is that we are generally seeking to maximise our non-greenbelt housing allocation. So obviously this policy is kind of dovetailing to similar thinking in the local plan must give the ability for some industrial land, perhaps once you've described it, it's never going to be used to go towards the housing sector. So it would add to the amount of brownfield sites that we're looking for. So I just need to be extremely cautious that it is, yeah.
I was just going to say, in all those X's that we've looked at before, that's the process that's going on now. So there will be land released that's currently industrial that we know. This in theory is a policy that will be in place when we've allocated what our, you know, so it ought to be from day one, it ought to be fairly robust that this is definitely the land we want to protect. And then, you know, 10 years from now, it might be a different kettle of fish, might it? But I would have thought, why should we give it if you've allocated a load of stuff for employment use and someone rushes an application in for something, you'd think, well, actually, we allocated this for employment use, you know, only yesterday, almost, you know.
Okay. Having said that, my only concern is that we often get reports site for X number of years. And I don't know what sort of evidence the landowner or the applicant has to provide to say there's been no interest. Now, I'll say, you know, a comparison is if you don't want to sell, if you don't, let's say you didn't want to sell your house, you tell them it was haunted, or you can develop a style. No, it's in
the question.
No, but you can develop a marketing style, can't you, that looks as though you're trying to promote a site.
Yeah.
Behind the scenes, you know, it's all you're doing is land banking. This is what a lot of companies do. They'll buy a site at an opportune moment and simply sit on it for a long period of time without any cost, any maintenance cost, development costs, or marketing costs. And they haven't actively been marketing it, but they seem to us when the application comes in, that does make them some money. Oh, they've been no interest in the site for 5 years. And I don't know what capability we have as local authority to interrogate these land bankers or landowners, how much marketing they've done. Now, I know we as an authority will market the borough in general and we'll say, well, go and have a look at this site. But I've no real feel for what control we have over developers. Simply sit on a piece of land for a long period of time, and then when an opportune moment comes, they say, oh, no one's been interested, use it for X, Y, or Z. So that's the sort of thing I'm trying to interrogate out of the doors.
I think from the United, it's also, if you don't want to sell your house, you ask for 3 million, don't you? I don't want to move, the wife wants to move, but we'll put it up for sale. We'll have 3 million, if you can sell it. I'm not going to see my house, I'll do a bit of selling for 3 million.
But my question is far more formal.
Yeah. Or you say, yeah, no, we've tried to get a tenant, but no one will pay the £1,000 money that we want. Well, that's not. They've always got to demonstrate that's what the going rate is, and they've offered it. What we did as a council, we put it to the auction with reserves, and test the market, see what it gets.
It helps. What we do in these types of situations is we will talk to the landowner or developer, and we will ask them for evidence of their marketing, certainly over 6 or 12 months. We also ask them where they have marketed the site, for what purposes, and we also talk to them about the grant assistance that may be available for employment uses and so on. So we're fairly rigorous in understanding why a site can't come forward. If we're not convinced that it isn't available for employment purposes and doesn't have reasonable prospects of coming forward, then you know we will not support that application. So just to give you some examples that you may